Now, I hope you've all had a very good break and a very nice lunch. My name's Quentin Peel, and I'm a Mercator senior fellow at Chatham House these days. But actually, for my life, I've been a journalist for the Financial Times for more years than I can bear to remember. But among other places, I was correspondent in Moscow, in Brussels, and in Berlin, all of which I think are quite relevant, although I've never been correspondent in Kiev. When anybody has to chair a session after lunch, it's always a slightly heavy task, although I know that you've all had lots of time to get out and about in the town. But I'm reminded of a wonderful story that they used to tell in Moscow in the old days about when Leonid Brezhnev was the Secretary General of the Communist Party. And he was at one of those great and ghastly Communist Party conferences that went on for hours and days, and he was giving his daklat. And he was well into the second hour when a little note came up to the podium, and it said, Leonid Ivanovich, there's a bomb in the auditorium. And he just ignored it and went on for another half an hour. And then another note comes up to the platform. Secretary General, there is a bomb in the auditorium. It's going to go off in 5 minutes. And he ignored it again. And finally, the note comes up saying, it's going off in 30 seconds. And he looks round and he sees the old grizzled old KGB colonel in the corner. And he calls him over and he shows him the note. And the colonel looks at the audience. He goes, row three, seat five. And they grab the guy. Sure enough, there's a bomb in his bag. They bundle him out. And everybody's safe. And Brezhnev turns to the old colonel. He said, how did you know? And the colonel looks at him and said, Mr. Secretary, you know what we always say. The enemy never sleeps. So, in spite of the lights, I've got my eye on you. Now, we have one of those suitably teasing and slightly ambiguous titles on a subject which is absolutely core to everything we're talking about these two wonderful days in Tallinn. And my compliments, like everybody else, to all the organisers, to Thomas and everybody who's got this together yet again. It's a wonderful event, and wild horses couldn't tear me away from it. The teasing title, Is There a Will? And is there a way? Ukraine, is there a will and is there a way? Now, does that mean, is there a will in Europe, in America, to really stand behind Ukraine? Perhaps. Is there a way in Ukraine to become the solid, stable, reliable partner that they're looking for? Or does it mean what somebody was rather naughtily suggesting to me? Well, actually, it means in Ukraine there's a will, but there isn't a way. But in the outside world, they know the way, but there's not much will. That's what I think we want to explore in this panel. And there is a real dilemma here, because here is Ukraine, that eternal borderland, that country on the edge, that is now the near abroad, not just for Russia, but also for the European Union. But there is a dilemma, because it seems that we have very different views outside Ukraine what we'd like the country to be. The European Union is desperate to have all its neighbours quiet and stable and prosperous, whereas Mr. Putin in the Kremlin appears to like to have his neighbours unstable, weak, and thoroughly nervous. Can we reconcile those two things? Well, that's what I want to ask the panel to do. And we've got a wonderful panel to do it. I'm going to go in the order that we're here and in the order that the speakers are sitting. Hanna Hopko, who was a demonstrator on the Euromaidan, elected to the parliament and is now chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the parliament in Kiev. And also I see, to my pleasure and alarm, Hanna, that you're a former journalist, so we all make mistakes. James Sherr is my good friend and colleague from Chatham House, where he's an associate fellow, but indeed was formerly the head of the Russia and Eastern Europe programme. And we've already heard him a couple of times intervene in a very clear speaking, clear thinking and inimitable way, we will hear it again now. I think the Prime Minister of Estonia probably does not need too much introduction to this audience, but the only thing I'm really alarmed to see is that you are exactly the same age as my son. which really puts
say
me
my,
in my place.
Say my best to your son.
And Ilya Ponomarev has the distinction of having been the only member of the Russian Duma who voted against the annexation of Crimea. For which he earns great credit in this audience and has totally ruined his career, political career in Moscow, I suspect.
Thanks God.
Anyway, so having put it like that, Hanna, is there a will in Ukraine and is there a way, which I think I'd really like to hear, to keep the country together and really stabilize it? It's a huge challenge. All yours.
Thank you for your question, and I'm honored to be here today and participate in the discussion. And I would like to ask a question to the audience. Is there a will in Europe to support the real democracy and the real values that Ukrainians are fighting for? Because for last more than year and 3 months, when the first time I came to Maidan to protest against Yanukovych's decision not to sign the association agreement, we were standing for the democratic values, European values. There were lots of people, more than 1 million people came to the Maidan to support a European way. And you know what happened the next. More than 100 people have been killed during Maidan. Probably Ukraine is the only country where people sacrificed their lives for the real democratic values. And now when you look at Ukraine and we see the real war, Russian aggression, annexation of Crimea, and over the 6,000 people, more than 6,000 people have been killed over the past year. This is the price that we are paying for become a strong country. And strong and a country that possibly could become a member of European Union. But we are doing our best to fulfill the association agreement. And to be honest, I could say that this is not an easy job. For 14 years, I used to be a civil society expert. I traveled to more than 35 countries in China, US, and others. So I, as a former expert of United Nations organizations, World Health Organizations, I could compare different countries and see that Ukraine really deserves its own way for development. And of course, we will be happy and we are really thankful for those countries who supported Ukraine, who supported territorial integrity, sovereignty of Ukraine. But also, we deserve our own way for the future that we want to see. And what I mean by this, there are lots of pressure on Ukraine, how we should live, what we could do with Crimea, or what we have to do with the eastern situation. We submitted the Minsk agreement, and actually Ukraine as a peaceful nation, we are fulfilling the Minsk obligations. And we would like to see the same reaction from Russian side. And of course, the crisis that started from annexation of Crimea will be over when Crimea returns to Ukraine. And when we are talking about sanctions, it's important to understand that. And there will be the moment of truth in June when European Union will have to extend the sanctions. And we will see the unity, the real unity of European Union, because in my personal opinion, the sanctions has to be till the moment when Crimea is a part of Ukraine. And I represent the new generation of change makers. And what I would like to say about the new parliament, lucky we are, there is no communist party there. And former party of regions has just a few seats there. They are in minority. And the coalition that was formed at the end of November last year is pro-democratic, pro-European coalition that has constitutional majority. Even if there are lots of attempts to destabilize, to disorganize the work of the coalition, now all politicians realize the price that we could pay if coalition will be broken, will be breaking. And also, why I could say that there is a will in Ukraine. And also, there is a way in Ukraine. And the last 4 months of parliament could prove that there are positive changes. What I mean by changes, the legislation that we already passed. Everybody here in this room might see what Kolomoisky reaction when the parliament passed the law on Ukrnafta, the state-owned enterprise, oil enterprises. And nobody believed that this parliament could manage to pass such legislation against one of the richest oligarchs in the country, former governor of Dnipropetrovsk, who used his patriotic intentions to support country to become rich. And parliament did it. And everybody seen these pictures, this fight when private army was protesting or was privatizing the company. But we solved this conflict. Another law against another oligarch, Firtash, who is sitting in Vienna, and we do hope that he has to be sitting in jail, not just in Vienna waiting for the decision. And we rely on US rule of law and support from Ukraine's General Prosecutor Office. And the law on gas market also was passed in Ukrainian parliament. Nobody believed that there will be a will to pass the law against Firtash. Very rich oligarch with, who is also an owner of TV, one of the most popular TV in Ukraine. Another legislation that were passed in Ukraine, I mean anti-corruption bureau, that we already, the bureau will start work in a few months, and the head of the bureau was selected in transparency procedure. Besides anti-corruption, de-oligarchization, two examples that I mentioned just 2 minutes ago, we passed several legislation on deregulation. We are thinking how to improve the investment climate in Ukraine to attract business companies, because it's important for us after deregulation to provide and to build the environment when investors could come to Ukraine and modernize Ukrainian factories. It's important for us to increase the export and support middle and medium-sized enterprises to build the middle class. It's really important to close this gap between the richest and the poorest in the country. Besides, I also would like to focus on another legislation that we managed to pass. We ban Russian propaganda movies at Ukrainian channels. The law was passed. There were some attempts to block this legislation from opposition bloc. Of course, pro-Russian forces, they are interested to use Ukrainian TV channel to show the propaganda. But Ukrainian parliament said no. And starting from June, all Russian movies with propaganda of Russian KGB, Russian police, prosecutor office will be banned at Ukrainian channels. Finally, we did it. Another law that we passed just 2 weeks ago, the law that will be banning the propaganda of communist regime. I'm happy to be here in Baltic States, in Estonia, because your country banned communist propaganda at the beginning of 90s when you got an independence. Unfortunately, Ukraine couldn't manage to ban the communist propaganda at that time. And all the symbols, the name of streets, the monuments of Lenin still there are in some cities in eastern part of Ukraine. And this is also the instrument that Putin, an aggressor state, used to attack this part of Ukraine. And there are lots of other examples that parliament now is a great tool to pass legislation and to provide changes in Ukraine. And this is also a good sign that we are building the parliamentarism in Ukraine. Before, unfortunately, there, with the vertical of Yanukovych regime, when just one man took a decision and the parliament was just followed the decision. Now we are bringing the new approaches, new culture by professionalism of the people in the parliament. And I represent the self-reliance political party, Samopomich. We were on the third place in the preterm parliamentary elections. When I took this decision, and some friend of mine told me, you know, Samopomich will never enter to the parliament. Look at the polls. You have only 1.2. It's not enough. You have 5%. And in 2 months period, you will never, not having the oligarch support and media, you will never get to the parliament. You should take the proposition from another political parties who are for sure will be in the parliament. I rejected all the propositions because for me it was very important to go for the first time to the politics with the party, with the transparency rules, when we published all the declaration of incomes, also all reports of sponsoring, who sponsored our campaign. And as you know, Samopomich got 11%. This is also show the how society is changing, the big demand for the change in the countries. And also we are now improving the coordination mechanism between parliament, government, and presidential administration. There are lots of new faces in government. And for those of you who already met Ukrainian Minister of Finance, Minister of Economy and Trade, these are the people who are real driver for changes. And now we are building the synergy between people in parliament, change makers in government, and presidential administration through the National Reforms Council. I also a member of executive board of National Reform Council. This is the platform when each month president, prime minister, and speaker of the parliament, together with the all cabinet and head of all committees, are sitting together and discussing the priorities. Never before such platform didn't exist in Ukraine. So we are also establishing the new mechanism how to push the reforms. And to be honest, it's not easy because oligarch influence still so high. And even this week, there were lots of coal miners protesters near the parliament. These are the people sponsored by Akhmetov and Medvedchuk. They financially supported all these activists to come to Kyiv and to destabilize situation in Kyiv to show that the coalition is not working well and also to put some and to break the unity between president and the parliament. And I can understand Putin's plans. It's important first to continue escalation of the conflict in the eastern part of Ukraine, to attack Kharkiv, providing terroristic attacks, also to make some destabilization in Odessa, but the most important, to destabilize the work in Kyiv, because never before parliament, government, and presidential administration work so hard and to show such unity. And I'll be finishing my my speech. And what I would like to say is that I believe in Ukraine, and I believe in the transatlantic unity, because this is the historical moment when we, through successful Ukraine, through making this Ukraine as a model, we could make a difference in Russia Federation. Ukraine has a special mission in 21st century. Because after last century, we survived. We survived after two world wars. We survived after artificial hunger organized by Stalin, after enormous number of repressions. A lot of Ukrainian intelligence, science intelligence, humanitarian and others, they were just sent to Siberia and killed there. But our nation survived. And I think that after all the aggressions that now Ukraine is facing, that European Union is facing, by aggression I mean military aggression, economic aggression, energy aggression, propaganda against Ukraine and the democratic values. We have to unite our efforts because Putin will not stop unless he is stopped. And yesterday somebody raised the question, do we have a plan B? What if tomorrow Putin move through Mariupol to Kyiv? And this is something that we have to be very prepared, having proactive positions to prevent such scenarios, to avoid the case when a million people could die. And because even having not so modern weapon, Ukrainians will protect our territorial integrity. And if tomorrow Putin will attack Mariupol, I'm sure that all Ukrainians will be protecting Ukraine. And this is the clear message why we need a defensive weapon. Defensive weapon to protect the values of Europe. Defensive weapon to protect the real democracy and to protect Europe. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Hanna. Thank you very much for a very profoundly felt, I think, statement of why you need and deserve that support. Let me just ask you one thing. You have to rebuild trust between your communities, not least in the recovered territories that have been won back in the East. How do you propose to go about that? To rebuild the trust of Russian speakers who've been in areas, they're now liberated areas, can you win back their support?
I think that we have to reintegrate the Donbas area by supporting people there. But unfortunately, Ukraine now could not deliver the humanitarian aid to those regions. Even OSCE mission is not allowed to be present there. And if you look at the OSCE observer mission, not special monitoring mission, at Ukraine-Russia border, there are only two checkpoints that cover just 4 kilometers out of more than 400. Every day, Russia continues to send troops, military assistance to the eastern part of Ukraine. And for us, it's important to get international support to take care about Ukrainians who are now at occupied territory.
That wasn't the question I asked. I asked how you're going to win back the trust of the Russian speakers.
By supporting people there, by reconciliation programs, because this is the Ukrainian people that will...
Yeah, but you recognize that there's an issue there to be dealt with.
Yes, we understand that it's one issue to recover the economy there, but also the destroyed industrial type of economy at that eastern part of Ukraine. This is a good chance for us, opportunity to build a new type of economy, innovative type of economy. And we already negotiating with different investment companies about focusing on IT innovation and for these regions to provide people there with jobs and to show some improvements. Because people who are now in Lugansk, when they move to Kramatorsk, they have to see some positive changes in Kramatorsk, not in Kyiv. Yeah. To see that they want to be a part of successful Ukraine.
And to guarantee the use of the Russian language too? Oh, of
course. I want to answer that there is no problem with Russian language in Ukraine. The only problem with Ukraine language. I personally speak Russian, English, Ukrainian, Polish language, but there is no one issue with Russian language. And I'm lucky that now Ukrainians became one political nation. And all speculation that former Party of Regions, Communist Party, and now opposition's bloc used to speculate on language issues, the same like on NATO and custom union issues. Now they could not speculate because people, it doesn't matter which language you speak in Ukraine. It's the most important that you are the Ukrainians that wants to protect your country. There is a huge level of patriotism in Ukraine, and we are really one political nation. And this is something that we achieved last year. And this is something that will give us a hope that as Putin expects to see that Ukraine will fail, Ukraine is a hopeless state. No, Ukraine is a state, is a country with a huge level of patriotism, with level of professional and well-educated people that now will use all the challenges as opportunities to build a strong country. And for 23 years of our independence, Russia, through their agents in different Ukraine institutions, destroyed Ukraine's army, Ukraine's economy. And now, with the support of United States, Canada, European Union, we are training our soldiers. We are looking for opportunities to invest in our defensive industry. So we will have the modern army till the end of this year. And this is also our way to become a strong country with strong army, with strong economy. And this is also an answer how we will build trust with the Russian speaking.
Well, thank you very much, Hanna, because I'll now move straight to James beside you, who is a great expert on such security issues, among others, but has spent a lot of time in Ukraine and seen it in all its strengths and all its weaknesses. James, have we the will and is there a way?
The reason, Quentin, it's difficult to answer the question is this. A year ago, when I was at the Lennart Meri conference, the response here to the issues we were dealing with was encouraging. But the response of the West was very much in the balance. Today, the West is displaying far better understanding and resolve than it did a year ago. But the concern I have, which could be crucial, is that our understanding is still lagging behind the dynamics of the conflict we are dealing with. And let me address this on two levels. We collectively, not in this room, but amongst Western decision makers, still have great difficulty understanding the calculus of Russian thinking and the balance between Russian strengths and Russian weaknesses. And if we don't understand that, we don't understand the real correlation of forces and we keep ending up getting surprised. The whole sanctions policy has been built on a correct assumption that economically the West is far stronger than Russia, but GDPs do not win wars or prevent them. Wars are countries deter war or defend themselves through the intelligent and confident application of national power against another side's national limitations and weaknesses. Russia is using today all the means of power, military, diplomatic, economic, informational, to emasculate Ukraine, to fragment it, to render the state unviable and have the West pay for it. And the Russians understand better than we do that in this conflict, time is a strategic variable. Now, the fact is that if the sanctions in their present form continue and the low oil price continues, within 2 to 3 years, it is going to be extremely difficult for the Russian state to continue to function in a normal way and pursue its present priorities. But if you say to half the governments of Europe who endorse the sanctions, it's going to take 2 to 3 years, they'll say, oh no, we never wanted to buy into this. So there's a basic incongruity in our policy. And in the meantime, the Russians have cards in the short term, military cards that are not being answered and that we are afraid to answer. And there's one final dimension of this I'll mention before turning to Ukraine. The dynamics of the situation in Russia, in the elite, have now created an equation in the minds of the regime between Ukraine's defeat and emasculation and possible destruction and the survival of Russia itself. And in their mindset, whatever damage Russia sustains, if Russia can defeat and destroy its opponent, it emerges victorious. And that is what we are dealing with. Now, to move on to Ukraine, here is the key enigma. A country with 40% annual inflation, with a state and bureaucracy that is still deeply corrupted and dysfunctional, is holding its own in the largest war we have seen in Europe against a nuclear power employing of late the most advanced and sophisticated weaponry in its arsenal. Now, how is that possible, please? I do not think it is possible because of Poroshenko and Yatsenyuk, whoever they are, whatever their strengths and weaknesses. And at the risk of being very undiplomatic, I would say if everything depended on President Poroshenko, Prime Minister Yatsenyuk, and Ukrainian bureaucracy, Ukraine would not exist today. Ukraine exists today and is holding its own because over the 15-year period, there has been an extremely impressive growth of a parallel state, which we loosely call civil society, whose ethos has been during all this time, we rely upon ourselves. And whose ethos now in this war is, whatever happens to us, we are still here. And that, what Russia has done in Ukraine, it has created a people's war. And whatever the Russian pain threshold, Ukrainians have demonstrated that their pain threshold is higher. And there is a basic discipline in Ukraine on the part of all people. Whatever we think of our leaders, and you will not find many Ukrainians who think that their leaders are genuine reformists, whatever they think of their leaders, the view is the war comes first, and then we will deal with all of that. And the problem for the West is to more effectively be able to convince that society we are standing with them, and we are working with them, not only against the external enemy, but against all the factors inside the country that are obstructing change. Final point. Our success is going to depend on two things. To put a counterfactual, if the key players in the West had said to President Putin at the very beginning, however important Ukraine is to you, the issue for us is equally important. It's not Ukraine. It is the maintenance of the legal, political and security order of Europe. And for us, that is a vital interest. And we want you to know, and you ought to understand, we will do everything short of war to uphold those interests and make sure you fail. I think had we said that, we would be in a very different place now from the place we are in. But to get to that point, we first have to agree amongst ourselves that it is a vital interest, and I don't think we have that agreement. The second, Ukraine's survival depends on its authorities and people. And the authorities are, of course, only under pressure, creating the conditions that give minimal confidence to the country's middle classes, to its entrepreneurs, and to investors, internal and foreign, so that the situation stabilizes. Because whatever we want, the political reality is, if the current IMF program is perceived to be wasted and funding political games and corruption and malpractice and malfeasance, Ukraine will be left to get the next tranche of aid from Moscow. And on that cheerful note, I'll stop. Thank you.
How long have we got, James? You say it'll take at least 2 to 3 years. I would say, standing back, and after all, we're 24 years since independence now, and things haven't changed dramatically, it's going to take another 24 years.
Well, I think with Russia, if we do the right thing, it will take 2 to 3 years. The worry I'm expressing is that the issue in Ukraine can be decided in a matter of months. And that's what this, that
the
is
wrong
what's
way.
Staring us in the face, against
yeah.
us.
Yeah.
Yes, very yeah. much so.
Prime Minister, Taavi, Rõivas. The challenge that Hanna put to us, basically, non-Ukrainians, was, is there the solidarity in Europe, the will to really support Ukraine? What's your answer to that?
Mm-hmm. Well, I will come to this will part a little bit later, but
okay.
First...
Start with the way.
I had to say that there has to be a way, because this is not about Ukraine, this is about the security architecture of Europe and transatlantic environment. So there has to be a way, and the question whether Ukraine will fall or survive is the main question of the stability of all of Europe. So it's not that important whether we talk about the frozen conflict or federalization of Ukraine. What really matters is that this has a lasting impact on European security, and this divides the line of power for 10, 20, perhaps even 30 years to come. So it's not so much about tactical changes or reallocation of forces in eastern Ukraine, but it's about the whole of Ukraine. And I would say that we should not create any illusion that Minsk II or some sort of solution in the Middle East, for example, would bring us long-term lasting stability in Europe. So I'm pessimistic enough to say that if Ukraine falls, that will give Russia a successful case for action for the future. And this is something that we cannot afford, definitely. So, as I said, the outcome of the war will determine the security architecture for the next couple of decades, and whether it will be value-based, whether it would be norm-based, or there will be this kind of superpower that thinks it's more or less okay to intervene to other sovereign countries' business. And of course, it goes without saying that Central and Eastern European countries are very much influenced by this outcome. Now, to the question, is there a will and what can we do or have we been doing enough? First and foremost, it's about Ukraine, Ukrainians and their strength and how they really believe in Ukraine. Yesterday it was on the table, Anders Aslund said that the current government is the best government Ukraine has ever had. James was a little bit more critical to that, but I would say that having several meetings with both government members and also President Poroshenko, looking very closely at their statements and what they say privately face to face, I would be more on that side saying that that they have the strength, they have the will. If you think of what people and the international community expect from the wartime leaders, they expect determination, clear messages, both outside and to the public. I would say this is very much there. But the other hand, or the other problem, is that whether this task is too big. You know, in our countries, in most of our countries, people come to streets for very small policy changes. In Ukraine, the country is in war, whatever you say legally, but de facto the country is in war. And at the same time, they have to do huge reforms that are extremely painful. The country has experienced more than two decades of enormous corruption, and to get it out just like that, this is a tremendous challenge. And I will say once more that whilst the country is in war, so it's not an easy task for the political leader. What is making me more optimistic about this all is that I have sensed a very strong will from the people of Ukraine. I haven't been traveling all over Ukraine, but in Kiev, all the meetings I have had, including 22nd February events in Maidan, I saw a clear will from the Ukrainian people. And this is something that counts really, because for them, this is a freedom war. And whilst they have this kind of motivation, this means a lot, even if they are against a much bigger and stronger enemy. Now, our policy towards Russia, whatever they say, I think Russia shows very robust intervention against Ukrainian democracy. And Russia has definitely positioned itself. Russia will not hold back. So Russia is ready to sacrifice a lot. That is the key to this aspect. And third, of course, what we, the West, can do to influence the future of Ukraine. First of all, it's of course our policy towards Russia. We need to continue the policy that convinces Russia that its actions in Ukraine do have clear consequences and they will be harmful for Russia. It goes without saying that we need to continue with the economic and sectorial and all kinds of sanctions and travel restrictions. It was on the table yesterday. I agree with many things that was said, but I'm slightly less pessimistic or even would say that I do not share the pessimism on EU unity. And I'm quite certain that this message that was given already in March, that there definitely will be a rollover of the sanctions when the Minsk II is not fully implemented. That was a clear signal to the outside world. So I would expect I don't see the possibility of Minsk II being fully implemented by June. Sorry to say that. But while that is not done, there will be clearly a rollover. And this is not just me defending my club of the EU Council. And this is really saying what I really see there around this table, where there is only 31 people present, sometimes the unity is much more there than we read from the newspapers.
I want to pursue you on that a little bit, if I may, because, I mean, in Germany, where I've just been until last year, the agreement on sanctions was presented as actually a great European triumph, that Europe had held together, and Angela Merkel was, I think, quite happy to take quite a lot of the credit for that. But it's got to be unanimous to roll over the sanctions, and people are saying, well, they won't be they will be rolled over if, basically, the deal is still not done. Will they be rolled over then as long as Crimea is still annexed? What happens about Crimea?
Well, we should definitely not forget about Crimea, and I think this is a unanimous decision also in the EU Council. I think the main, language that is important in these decisions that were taken on March is until the full implementation of Minsk II. Full implementation of Minsk II, well, for me, it says that there has to be control over a sovereign country, and these kind of things don't unfortunately happen overnight. So I would say there will be a rollover of the sanctions. I do know, and sometimes I even share the slight, not pessimism or critique, I would say, about the sanctions perhaps not being enough, not being strong enough. On the other hand, we have to understand that this is a strong precedent for Europe and for 28 countries having this clear signal. Today, I would also argue that the sanctions definitely work. You were saying that the burn-down time of Russia will be 2 to 3 years. I would argue, taking three variables, gas, oil, and their reserves, I would argue that it could be even less. It could be a year, year and a half. The question, what is really important then, and what was very problematic in January, is whether the burnout time of Ukraine is less. And in January, when I talked to Arseniy Yatsenyuk, he was very pessimistic, saying that if we don't get the funds from Europe and US and our allies, we will be on our knees in a couple of months. At the same meeting, he got the note that US had helped them with $2 billion. Some days later, they get the note that the EU was there to help them too. So actually, we can make a difference in this respect. And we can make the burnout time of Ukraine much longer, so that even, you know, it doesn't happen, this kind of situation where Putin believes that he cannot do it with militarily, but it can he can do it somehow economically. We can prevent that, and we have to be there for Ukraine. But on the other hand, the help or the financial aid has to take into consideration, of course, that Ukraine has to keep reforming. We have to be persistent in demanding reforms, but understanding that the challenge the Ukrainian leaders are having is tremendous. The society has so much corruption, so much problems, so it doesn't come overnight, even if we would like to see much faster progress. And we have to really reassure Ukraine also that the path they have taken is right, and we need to support their economy and normalize their living standard. Perhaps we should even consider establishing sort of Marshall Plan for 21st century, something like that for Ukraine, because you know, supporting Ukraine with the people's ambition to take a Western direction is something very important. So my last point is that the regional conflict in Ukraine should never become a global crisis, and in this regard, I would once more emphasize that supporting Ukraine is critical. And we have to be, of course, at the same time, very clear that also NATO Article 5 is very firm and rock solid. So I think all the steps that NATO has taken, including positioning itself in its eastern borders, are very, very important. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Ilya Ponomarev. Your credentials are clear, But I want to ask you this. Is there any reason on earth why Mr. Putin should stop doing what he's doing? It's making him massively more popular in Russia. It's reinforcing his power. Why should he stop?
Well, we're all mortal. That can be the reason.
I won't take that as either a threat or a promise.
You know, that's the situation in nowadays Russia, that both the opposition and the power likes to come to this kind of comparisons and remarks. Like the opposition always say that we're all human beings and that Putin is not eternal, you know, and that's a very bad sign. That's definitely a sign that somebody lacks will. But I want to comment on what was said so far. What would I definitely agree is that the situation in Ukraine is not a local conflict. I think that what I always argue with our friends in the White House, which think that ISIS is something which is like a real global threat, I think that ISIS is not a real global threat. That is a regional thing. I think what is a real global threat is things like RT, Russia Today. That is a global threat. Because what we are fighting for right now is we are fighting for values, for fundamental values of our civilization, if you will. It's not a situation of a piece of land, whether it's a very important piece of land or not so important piece of land. It's not about piece of land. It's about the nature of world and future, whether we should treat the current architecture with the approach of not even 20th century, but of 19th century, of spheres of influence, et cetera, or we are building a common house. Whether we try to eliminate the borders or we're trying to build new ones. And I think that what we see right now in eastern Ukraine, that's actually a result of approach from both sides. It would not be fair to say that it was just Russia. Of course, we are at fault with what's happened, but it's all started from the proposal for European Association, which was very much predicted from the very beginning that it would be taken as attempt to exclude Russia from integration processes. It was never offered to Russia to actually be part of that process. I don't stop reminding that Putin's foreign agenda, when he was first time running for his office in the year 2000, was based on three cornerstones. First, accession of Russia to NATO. Second, accession of Russia to European Union. Thirdly, accession of Russia to WTO. We remember how much time it takes to get Russia to WTO. And I can tell you also that was not only Russia's fault. I know very well negotiators from our side which were doing all this. It was a very tough negotiation process. And the other two things were turned out from the very beginning. And was it beneficial for the global stability? No, it was not. Right now, we are at this situation when we are debating about the will. And so in Russia, I think we see the will for the first time during the last 25 years. Whether it's a good will? Probably not. Actually, Putin is right now implementing a lot of things that, for example, I myself was advocating for years. RT is among them. Because I wrote maybe a dozen of memos to presidential staff during the last 10 years saying that we should create a kind of media channel or a civil initiative to try and to get ourselves aligned with progressive forces all across the globe, so that we are talking across the borders, we are thinking across the borders, not only through the existing institutions. And finally, it is created with a very opposite purpose, to exactly disrupt.
Now we know.
Yes. And what is the alternative? I actually was listening very attentively to Hanna, you know, pitch, and I really enjoyed your passion through which you were speaking. But you know, we're good friends, so it's like, that's why a little bit of criticism. You know, if I would be Ukrainian, I would definitely vote for your party. For a very simple reason.
Just let me correct. I'm not the member of any party. In Ukraine, it's allowed to be a part of party list. I was the number first in the party list of Self-Reliance, but I'm not the member of this party. And I think that we have to amend electoral code in Ukraine and to build an environment when new political parties, when just not a group of people behind of one leader, then real political parties will be established in Ukraine. And okay, we are working on this.
I think Ilya's made his point, nonetheless. Yes, but he likes the sound of the party that you're not quite a member of. Sounds a bit like Mr. Putin and Yedinaya Rossiya, but anyway.
You are actually slipping it from my tongue. Because what I was listening to you, it was exactly what United Russia in our parliament is saying, the way how you deliver this speech. And I think that actually the beauty of your party is that you are not a member of that party, is that the name of the party is Samopomoc, is self-assistance, is actually the only party, real party of Maidan. That's what our societies lack. Because this is a party which is supposed to replace government's will with people's will. And that's what I think is actually happening in Ukraine and what I am trying to propagate in Russia, to learn from Ukrainians this passion of people's will, which we saw and which we still see. The question is that if you try to replace it with like unanimous constitutional majority, with its push from the top, it actually destroys the idea. And it's very worrisome what you are saying about, like, now we prohibited all the symbols of the past. The best way how to overcome the past is to show that the future is better. If people would see that the future is associated with prosperity, if the movement is going in the right direction, they would never be nostalgic of what is gone. And right now, Putin is applauding you when you are passing these regulations on prohibiting the symbols of the past. Because now he says, you see, those people would teach us the democracy. You see, those people are prohibiting the parties. Those people are prohibiting the symbols. Those people are prohibiting the ideologies. It's not good. And I think that if we do a little bit more synchronization of values between ourselves, we actually would be in a way better position than we are right now. And the challenges that we are facing, Russia and Ukraine, are exactly the same. Thank you.
Okay, Ilya, thank you very much. That's excellent. Now, I'm going to throw it open to the floor in the front row here. Second Chatham House rule is never recognize anybody on the floor, otherwise everybody will be insulted. But here in the front row is my good colleague, Orissa. Oh, sorry, Orissa, at the front. It's coming here.
Thanks, Quentin. I thought it's the first Chatham House rule not to give a colleague from Chatham House the floor, but obviously it's not the rule. Thanks so much. Excellent panel, excellent issues. I have a question to Hanna, actually related to what James said about these parallel institutions in Ukraine, because there are lots of Ukraine watchers who know Ukraine has a strong society. Do you see any of these parallel institutions that could be brought on board into a formal institutions? Because what Ukraine needs is the strong new quality governance that will ensure that we don't repeat mistakes of 2004. and that gives sustainability to the Euromaidan ideas and values. And my second question is to James about what is happening from your perspective in Ukrainian military and security reform, because this is a fundamental question to what Anna was appealing about providing Ukrainian defense weapons. When I travel globally, people sometimes make reference to the Middle East militia battalions. Is it risky, not risky? Would you make this comparison or not? Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Now, a little bit further over in the second row there. Who had their hand up, yes? Just tell us who you are.
I'm Peter Balaj. I am the head of the support group for Ukraine of the European Commission. So we work regularly with our Ukrainian colleagues, including with Hanna. And I would like to touch upon three issues. First of all, on following on your point whether the will in Ukraine. I think that the will is certainly there in the top political leadership, and there are really first steps also in practice to carry through these reforms under very difficult conditions. But what is still questionable, whether there will be enough will also to face down the strong resistance, both from the still very strong influence of oligarchs and also the skepticism of the population, because all these reform measures undoubtedly cause major hardships for the population, and this is clearly used by Russia. My second point about the there were doubts about the EU's overall assistance, without going into details, let me just point out that the EU is by far the largest source of support in all forms, be it through its 28 members states of the EU provide 30% of the quota of the IMF. On top of that, EU provides also bilaterally the non-assistance, both in form of soft loans and grants. The EU is the only country which unilaterally opened its markets to, without any reciprocity, to the Ukrainian products. The EU helps in the energy area, and the EU is also through a group task forces like ours helps in expertise and in other ways the transformation. One could say that more would be needed, but I think that the truth is that under the present conditions there is an expectation from the EU to see the first results of the reforms. And finally, to Mr. Ponomarev, again, without going into details, you are wrong when you say that the same cooperative approach was not offered to Russia. In 2007, 2008, there were even negotiations about a future free trade agreement with Russia. However, in 2009, Russia turned in a different direction in setting up its customs union. And from that onwards, the Russian trade policy became closed, more and more closed, and there is no real interest today from Russia to open its markets. I don't know whether you share this view, but this is strongly the impression in Brussels.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, right in the middle here, I saw, I'll have to say who it was, Anders Osland.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm Trivim Velist of Estonia, and I promise I will be very brief.
That was a hijack.
Yeah. Well, I would like to thank the panel, but above all, I would like to thank Hanna Hopko for what she said at the end of her statement, and that was, I believe in Ukraine. And I think this is crucial. If many Ukrainians say the same, then I think we will have a future for Ukraine. But having said that, I have a question, a follow-up question on Ukrainian identity. You mentioned that language is not an issue. So please, what is the key element, or what is the core element of Ukrainian identity, and where are the most distant and most fundamental roots of Ukrainian identity? The Kremlin, the Moscow Kremlin claims that the cradle of the Russian state is in Kiev. So what would you say to that, and where are the roots of Ukrainian identity? Thank you.
Thank you. Can you pass it over now to Anders?
Thank you very much, Quentin, and thank you for excellent presentations. I would like to pick up on what Prime Minister Rõivas said, that the EU can make the difference and make a certain difference to my friend here, Peter Ballas. Of course, the EU can do more and should do it exactly now, and specifically what is needed. It's to reinforce the reserves. That can be done with a swap credit from the European central banks of, say, 10 billion euro. This is approximately what is needed. And then you immediately say, but won't the money be stolen? No, because the central banks can impose strict conditions, approximately as happened with a Polish stabilization fund in 1990. So the money can't really be used, because if the government goes in that, too far in that direction, it will have to make changes, but the money is there for the market, and this is a guarantee for the exchange rate so that we won't see the collapse. Ukraine had a real financial meltdown 23rd to 25th of February. That must not happen again. And therefore, Peter, the EU can and should do more, and the time is now. Thank you.
Okay, fine. I think I better go back to the panel. Hanna, most was focused at you.
I would like to pick the question about Ukraine's identity, because it's a very important question. Why it's important?
Well, it is. But Hanna, if you said I don't believe in Ukraine, you wouldn't be sitting here.
No. I have a book with me. This is the book about Ukraine's history, and I'll give this book to you. Ukraine Incognita Top 25 Articles about Ukrainian History. And there is, for those who never been to Kyiv, there is St. Sophia Cathedral, the beautiful and ancient mosaics. St. Sophia Cathedral in Kyiv was built at the beginning of 11th century, when Moscow didn't exist. And when Putin and his propaganda said that Ukraine is an artificial country, usually I answer, please visit Kyiv, come to St. Sophia Cathedral, and you'll see the real artificial country. So
that's
this is
our
book.
Whole point, that we are one country, and, you know.
And
from
all
Kyiv.
The projects, like Ruskiy Mir, Russian World, Novorossiya, this is the project against Ukrainian history, Ukrainian identity. Because even if the Ukraine's independence is only 23 years old, but Ukraine as a country is more than 1,000 years old.
One of the fascinating and very difficult things about Ukraine and Russia is you have two countries fighting for the same narrative. It's very difficult. It's the same narrative.
The same, I would disagree, because you have to learn more the history. Because
please, Hanna, I don't want to lecture on that.
This is very important to understand that Kyiv Rus was much earlier than Moscow appeared at the global map. Mm-hmm. And all the projects like Ruskiy Mir and others, when Putin tries to build the big monument in Moscow to send Vladimir was in Kyiv, not in Russia. Russia didn't exist at that moment. And when Ukrainian king Yaroslav Weiss was getting married his daughter to Norway and to France, this is what? How could you just say that it wasn't exist?
So you're proving that we're one country. Wait, we should just surrender to you and reunite.
Maybe.
I know it's very difficult.
In Soviet Union, we were one country. It was just because of the pressure. We had to be a part of Soviet Union. But we are.
So, yes.
Now, can we come to the present? And yes. You were challenged about on reform and on the need for strong governance.
As for the other questions about Orissa asked about civil society role, I think that Ukraine needs both. Strong civil society, and the civil society organizations had to make the government, the parliament, more professional, more accountable, more responsible. This is their critical role. And also, we have to build strong institutions through reforming the judiciary system, reforming police, prosecutor office. This is very important for us. And the first legislation on judiciary reform was passed in the parliament. And the next legislation are prepared and will be considered in the parliament. So I agree that both strong civil society and strong institutions that we are forming now. Because without strong institutions, it will be hard, even if you have very professional people in cabinet of ministers, in parliament, institution is the key. Are the key.
James, do you want to pick up on one?
I want to pick up briefly on a couple points. First, I want to support Hanna in a very modern context. The modern Ukrainian state, can we please remember, Leonid Kuchma in 1994 was the candidate of the East with a machine from Dnipropetrovsk. He was the architect of the distinctive partnership with NATO. I worked with his administration. They were largely Russian-speaking. The constitution, which gave Ukrainian the status of a state language, also specifically mentioned the Russian language and guaranteed its status in all other spheres. This has been an issue from the beginning, deliberately whipped up and blown out of all proportion, not only by ideologues in Russia and by some ideologues in Western Ukraine. Second point, coming to the direct question that Alicia asked me, unfortunately, so far, defense reform in Ukraine has been almost entirely a bottom-up process. There are many battalions of the National Guard and the Ministry of Defense who will not accept orders from anyone in Kiev above the rank of major or colonel because the distrust is so deep. The irony is, in the past, when Ukraine was less democratic under Kuchma, there was very impressive defense reform. Now there is virtually none, and President Poroshenko is extremely resistant to military advice, but that is a bigger issue. And I cannot just finally, Quentin, if I may, pick up on a very important point made by the Prime Minister. When he mentioned, when he linked, as we now do, the sanctions issue to Minsk. Well, that's very interesting, isn't it? Because when this started, we linked our policy to the restoration of Ukraine's independence, sovereignty, and territorial integrity. Read the Minsk agreements. Implementation of the Minsk agreements creates, with our blessing, legitimizes a frozen conflict and de facto authority of people in the East, whose election we also in Congress do not recognize as legitimate. So here is a case where we declare a goal and we immediately contradict it with another, and the Russians are supposed to be impressed with our resolve. I fully understand why the Kremlin draws a different conclusion. Thanks.
Prime Minister, Anders Aslan says the EU can do more and should do more. And is the conditionality actually too tough?
Well, first of all, of course, connecting the future actions to the full restoration of Ukraine's sovereignty, getting Crimea back, that's also an option and could be much stronger, I agree with you, than connecting it to Minsk too. But I clearly see that the main thing is that the sanctions have to continue while the aggression continues, and if necessary, the sanctions can be toughened as well. But I won't agree with those who say that the sanctions don't work or they are unnecessary in this respect. I think the more time we have given them, they have actually made Russia feel them. And this is, again, all about this burn time. We can make the burn time for Russia shorter. And at the same time, when we help Ukraine to finance their reforms, also with financial aid and loans from EU, but also other allies, then we can really make a difference. I wouldn't underestimate the impact of economy at all. You know, some say, sometimes this irritates me a lot, some say that perhaps, you know, when we make Russia too weak economically, perhaps they will be even less stable. Come on, do we see any stability in their actions? I would argue no. And saying that, you know, they would be less stable when they are financially weak, I would argue that is totally wrong, because you know, the Berlin Wall didn't come down when Soviet Union was economically very strong, and weak Russia economically also means that they have less finances for army and for firing against independent countries in their neighborhood. And the third thing, what we can do even more, but what we are doing as well, and this is a role where Estonia has a role to play, is to share our experience in reforming. 24 years ago, Estonia, but also Latvia, Lithuania, other countries, were at exactly the same starting point as Ukraine is now. We took totally different paths. We decided immediately to go towards the EU, towards NATO, different choices, definitely. But we can now share the experiences, what we did right, what we did wrong, and this is our moral duty to do that. So this is something we have to continue doing.
Okay. Ilya, did you want to come in at this stage, brief intervention on any of those points? Otherwise, I'll carry on.
Yeah, I just wanted to say it's, we should be very careful with the language we use. And I wanted to address what Prime Minister said about the burnout. We saw very long burnout in Greece. But it's still burned. And what I'm very much afraid is that with the current way how the foreign assistance is structured for Ukraine, it would be very much the same result. Because what Ukraine needs is Ukraine needs to grow economy. It doesn't need to prolong the situation with debt. It needs to invest into entrepreneurship. It has to be a new tax base. It has to be new companies. And right now, even the current government, Han also knows that I have this debate with them, they are forced to increase taxes to sustain the budget, even with all the foreign, even with all the foreign aid. And as a result, the economy base is shrinking and not growing. And if we look at like issues like energy independence and restarting its own production, or for example, natural gas, the increase of the fiscal regime actually results in the production to be stopped rather than be increased. And the increase of the dependency rather than increasing the, of the dependency. And I think this is something that when we are talking about foreign assistance, we should always keep in mind.
Thanks very much, Ilya. Now, I want to get two more rounds of questions, one from the middle, one from the right. Gentleman who's wearing the Ukrainian colors with a yellow tie and a blue shirt, or are they the Swedish colors, perhaps? Right behind you.
Thank you so much. Hanna just declared that she believes in Ukraine. I think we need to answer the question, do we believe in Europe? Europe not as a place of comfort and well-being, but Europe of values and solidarity. About the will, I think we need the will to act, not only make declarations. And the question is whether this reaching this stage would mean that we'll start to feel real alarm, real fear, that Ukraine means also something for Europe, something to lose. Then my question is, have we wasted in the West too a chance to take use of the Orange Revolution? Because we helped it to achieve victory, but immediately after, I am a member of the European Parliament, I remember how we sent signals, don't come too close. And for some time, it was a taboo word to express that Ukraine has a right for the EU membership. Now, 4 days ago in Brussels, Patriarch Filaret declared very clearly that Ukraine's destination is membership of the European Union. That would provide stability. How is our position today? And the last observation, excuse me.
Can you make it
do you find any similarities between the Polish Solidarność movement, which was preceded by a mighty moral and spiritual consolidation, and that of Ukraine today? And do you need this? Is there something about it? Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now, there are two ladies here in the second row competing for the microphone, so I'll have to give it to both of them. Yeah, the lady with the glasses first.
Okay, we can both do it together.
Tell us who you are.
Tina Hidashel, Member of Parliament of Georgia. I want to refer to the Prime Minister's comment when he was saying that there has to be a way for the Ukraine not to fail. And I think that's the most important part of this whole discussion, because I don't believe in the chances of Ukraine failing without the rest of the world failing together with the Ukraine. I think that if Ukraine fails, the NATO fails, European Union fails, all of us will fail, and the whole security and stability infrastructure of Europe will fail that was created after the Second World War. I don't believe that there is a war between Ukraine and Russia, that Moscow is challenging Kiev or Tbilisi for the same reason. I think Moscow is challenging everybody else but Kiev and Tbilisi. They are challenging Washington, they are challenging Brussels and all the other capitals in the world. And you had a very strong point about helping Ukraine economically, about being there for them not to burn out, about the Article 5, but I think that's not what Ukraine needs today. Well, yeah, they need economic assistance, I don't doubt that, but I think there is something else more needed and more important as a support tool and instrument for the Ukraine right now, for them not to fail, and together with them, the entire European security infrastructure not to fail together with Ukraine. Yeah, my question is, if the, referring to what was referred here lots of times, to Anna's last sentence about believing in Ukraine, can we say so proudly that we believe in NATO as well? Because you said Article 5, do you believe that by challenging whatever Putin is challenging today, he's challenging Article 5 as well? And eventually, if all that works for him, he's going to challenge Article 5 as well. And the last question is, what is the deadline? Is it Kiev? Is it Dnipropetrovsk? Or how far Russia should go for the NATO member states to really give the assistance Ukraine needs today? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Now, the lady beside you.
Actually, I'm ambassador of Georgia, and I will let the floor to anybody else.
Okay, you're also from Georgia. Then there was a gentleman just behind. You know, I'm coming to the right in a second. Sorry, I'm keeping in the middle. Yes, the gentleman there with his hand up in the fourth row with the glasses.
Very briefly, my first question would go to James Sherr.
Just say who you are.
Anton Sherhasov, the Legatum Institute. My question is about the burnout time. Imagine that's 2 years, and imagine that Russia collapses. I think that would be an enormous challenge to the security in Eurasia. So are there any discussions about what this burnout may mean and how the West would respond to that? And my second question is for Hanna. You talked about the state institutions and you talked about the strong civil society, but as James mentioned, the civil society is essentially a parallel state. And for the state building process to be successful, there should be trust towards the state institutions. But again, this is a parallel state. And maybe it could be a problem that a civil society would just not believe and not trust the state institutions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And one question in the, yes, third row there on the middle.
Daniel Bosler, Süddeutsche Zeitung. Prime Minister, you said that we should show the Ukrainians that they're on the right path. And you said that Europe is much more united than it sometimes appears, referring to the sanctions. Now, would you say that Europe is united on the question where this path of Ukraine should lead to, namely, should it lead to membership one day, or would you say that is actually a matter of great conflict? And Hanna Hopko, would you say that not really hearing from parts from Europe where this path could lead, and if membership is an option, or if there is a European perspective, that actually makes your path more difficult? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Right, I'm coming back to the panel. Keep it very brief. Let's start on the NATO question, shall we? James?
Yes.
We've got 8 minutes, 38 seconds, and I want to have
very brief,
another round.
Very brief. We have four countries in Europe that are host to separatist movements. Belgium, the United Kingdom, Italy, and Spain. All of these are domestic issues only. Why? Because they are members of NATO and the EU. Because they take for granted a benign geopolitical environment which Ukraine has never had, because there is no neighboring great power, attempting to exploit these to weaken and damage and fragment a state.
But that's... there is no will within NATO to open the door to either Ukraine or Georgia in the foreseeable future.
That is not necessary for NATO to offer a membership perspective to Ukraine, for Ukraine to be made more secure. The synergy between what's in the EU association agreement and what could happen in Ukraine will itself do an enormous amount to make Ukraine more secure. Before all of this started, before Mr. Yanukovych came to power, there were a whole range of programs between NATO and Ukraine that were strengthening Ukraine, which were not predicated on membership at all. So it's not a black and white issue.
Okay. Prime Minister, would you like to take the same NATO?
Well, first of all, I mentioned Article 5 in a slightly different context. I mentioned that NATO has continued to show that it means business in defending all of its members. You know, it's very slippery slope to go saying what was the reasons back in, for example, 2008. Some said that the European door was not open enough. I would argue also that I remember being in Ukraine 2008, looking at the opinion polls, the support for NATO was less than 20% at that time. Support for EU was slightly higher, but not more than 25. Today, of course, the support for more has skyrocketed. But I think it's very important to make it very clear that trying something like that, what Russia has done in Ukraine, trying something like that against any NATO member country would never go through. That is something where we have to send a clear message. Don't even think about it. This was about Article 5. Now, whether the door of European Union is open, the accession agreements for Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia have all the 28 signatures of all 28 leaders of EU countries. I would say that, of course, that means the door is open. And of course, our next challenge is to give a clear signal from the Eastern Partnership Summit in Riga that there is a clear perspective for visa liberalization. There is a clear open door for those countries. This is not only Ukraine, but this is also Georgia and Moldova.
OK, thanks very much. Ilya, is NATO the red rag that Mr. Putin seems to say it is? Or is it much more about a fear of a popular movement like we've seen in Ukraine?
No, of course, NATO is not the most popular world institution, and Putin is playing heavily on that, using again the same RT and other means like that. What I think might very well happen with NATO is, imagine year 2017, and the eve of presidential elections in Russia, the effect of the invasion in eastern Ukraine and Crimea already worn off in Russia. Economic difficulties are there, probably not as severe as we have heard here, because still the trade balance is positive and things like that, but still the difficulties are there. And then Putin decides, maybe we test waters with Narva. Would Germany, for example, agree to exercise Article 5 in this situation?
Of course.
Especially, I'm not so sure.
I am.
You should.
I believe
you
in
should
NATO,
as an Estonian.
Sure. No,
I'm not sure.
Well, I have the word of US president, so I can be sure.
that's another point that I want to make.
And that's also the Anglo-America,
That we are right now talking about US-Ukrainian solidarity way more about an European-Ukrainian solidarity. We are talking about the supply of defensive weapons from US and not from Europe. And I am absolutely not sure. I think the whole rhetorics about nuclear weapons, et cetera, et cetera, is targeted exactly to provoke that situation. Because if NATO would not exercise Article 5 in the year 2017, then Putin is essentially dismantled NATO and is re-elected as a victor over NATO. Why wouldn't Europe supply defensive weapons to Ukraine? You have stockpiles of Warsaw Pact outdated weaponry, a lot of hardware in Poland, in Slovakia, in other countries.
Okay. Can I
good point.
Ilya, I just want to put your question about Germany and Article 5 to Daniel Brösler, who asked the last question. Daniel, could you answer the question whether Germany would be prepared to stand by Article 5 in the case of NATO?
Now we can say
bring the microphone here to the middle. I'll put you on the spot. It's all right.
The answer will
he
be very brief.
The Süddeutsche.
The answer will be very brief. I would yes. Article. I would say yes because okay. Everybody knows that NATO is dead. Otherwise, so right. I don't think that right. Federal government would like to kill NATO.
Okay, Hanna.
Let's hope we will not test it. Okay,
Hanna, I'm coming to you. And there was a question specially for you, Hanna,
about Solidarność.
Elio, have you not finished? Come on. Have you?
Yes, maybe. The Prime Minister, you wanted to add something.
Well, if I may, I'm quite sure that Putin has the memos. What did, for example, President Obama say here in Tallinn on early days of September? I think it was 3rd of September. He probably even has some overviews what was decided in Wales at NATO summit. So my suggestion is don't even think about it. About this... NATO solidarity, anyone who is slightly hesitating whether there is no NATO solidarity, whether there is Article 5, it means actually that they are not believing in NATO at all, because any square mile of NATO is, if NATO does not protect on one square mile of its territory, it loses any credibility or at all. So that would be insane to even think about it, whether there is NATO solidarity. But, of course, the clear and visible presence in bordering countries helps, that it's not only documents, but it's actually visible military presence.
Right. Hanna, I'm going to come to you in 2 seconds. I'm going to take two more questions over here, in the front row, and then I come to you first.
Okay.
Yes, Kadri.
Kadri, ECFR. I have a question to Hanna and I, maybe James as well, whoever answers. I was in Ukraine just a couple of weeks ago, and there was something that disturbed me. And I guess that's a myth, that Ukrainian population doesn't want to take hardship that comes along with reforms. Myself, I don't think that's the case. And I think that myth is shared by, on the one hand, richer part of the European Union, who don't understand how people can tolerate their living standards dropping and who haven't been through the early 1990s in Ukraine or here. We have seen one can tolerate it. But what makes me worried is that I sort of sensed that the top leadership in Ukraine shares that fear. In theory, their mandate for reforms could not be clearer. They haven't been in the office even a year, but they behave as if they are tired for fear government, or at least that attitude comes from that world. So is that the case? And if so, then how can you reform? Because civil society can help reforms only up to a point. The actual thing has to be done by the executive. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Kadri. Along the front row here.
Okay. thank you, Quentin. Sergei Alexashenko, non-resident fellow at Brookings. The title of the panel is There is a Will and There is a Way. I was in Kyiv as well 2 weeks ago, and I met with many government officials, and I trust you, there is a will. Definitely there is a will. A lot the government do today is not visible. And of course, they understand the price of the reform. And government has enacted as well civil society. It will take some time. It may take a year, it may take 2 years before we shall see fruits of this reform. But there is a will. Unless I haven't seen any action of the government that they have no will, or they are doing something else except of declares.
So
my question,
right?
No, the question is about the way. Is there a way for Europe and the United States, if there is a way for the West? As I understand, there is a very good game. Is it hard power or soft power. Mr. Putin wants the world of the future and the current world to be built on the hard power principles. And he uses, as James said, all his instruments in Ukraine. Hard power, hybrid war, information war, and so on. He's a fan of hard power because he has no soft power. Europe has both, and the West has both, hard power and soft power. If 300 American paratroopers that are in Ukraine today were deployed recently, were in Ukraine deployed 1 year ago, I believe there should not be any Donetsk and Luhansk. 300 paratroopers in Donetsk region a year ago in April 2014 could stop everything. They didn't. United States, okay, it's not our trouble. Ukraine is somewhere in Europe. Let Europe do it. Europe, as European Union, had no hard power, and they are not ready to resist. Europe had soft power. Soft power, as Prime Minister rightly mentioned, is Marshall Plan for Europe, but it is not on the table. I appreciate value that Europe pays 30% contribution to IMF credit to loan to Ukraine. Loan is the money Ukraine should repay in 5 years, in 7 years. Loan is not an assistance. Loan is money you receive for a short period of time. Ukraine had, 25 years ago, West has lost a chance to provide Marshall Plan for Russia. Now you pay the price. You may reject Marshall Plan for Ukraine today. Some years later, you will pay the price. So the way is hard power or soft power. How do you want to build the world of the future? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And one question here in the second row behind Kevin.
Thank you. I'm Mike Halsall, Finnish Institute of International Affairs and Johns Hopkins University back in Washington. A couple quick points. James, you should have added Bosnia and Herzegovina to the countries in Europe that have separatist movements, and they're not members of NATO, and the Russians are mucking around there. Ilya, I have the boundless respect for you, but honestly, you were really being disingenuous in saying that the West preemptorily slammed the door on NATO membership for Russia. Russia was not abiding by its Istanbul commitments, not agreeing to host nation consent. Putin was cutting out freedom of the media. That you know, it takes two to tango. When it comes to Narva and Article 5, the answer is simply yes. And let me just say, the doubts, I think, are predicated upon the geographical location of Estonia. Let me just explain a parallel, and that is, for 45 years, West Berlin had no more than 12,000 American, British, and French troops. It was surrounded by 400,000 troops of the East German Volksarmee and another 400,000 of the Red Army, and they didn't dare touch West Berlin because they understood what would happen. I certainly hope Mr. Putin understands the same thing about Article 5 today. My question is very short term, the next 6 weeks. Let's just assume that we all agree with James Sherr that the West should do everything that it can short of sending Western troops to help Ukraine. And let's be pessimistic, or I would say realistic, that after the May 9th celebrations and after the next rotation of inductees to the Russian army, Putin moves against Mariupol and other places. What do we do? I mean, the short term, even sending weaponry, defensive lethal weaponry, is not going to help. I would submit one thing you could do, and people who know much more about this than I do could argue with it, kick Russia out of SWIFT. I mean, there's something you could do. I know there are technical problems, but that would have an immediate effect. I'd like to ask the question, what do we do in the next 6 weeks if worse comes to worse? Thank you.
You very much. Panel, I've got 1 minute each for all of you. We're eating into the coffee break. This is very serious. I will get crucified for it. Hanna, I promised you the first word, and indeed, you got a very direct question there from Kadri straight away about... Has the leadership already actually got tired, almost, of exhausted by the reform process? Pick up as you will, but Kadri's question was, you know, the feeling that the leadership shares the fear that it's just that the hardship is too much to inflict on the people.
I could say that some reforms are painful, but painful for oligarchs. Some reforms like energy security reforms and tariffs increase are painful for the society. But Ukrainians are a very smart nation. We understand that for energy independence, we have to pay this price. And I do hope that all reforms together with anti-corruption measures and rule of law instruments, we will support the reforms on behalf of the Ukrainian government.
Would you like, is there any final word you'd like to say just to re, because I feel actually, and inevitably I think we'd get it from an audience like this, there is a tremendous feeling that there is a will. So the question is actually what Sergei
Now, now it's a time to build a strategy. Yeah. Strategy and have plan B and to show the unity when we are talking about the United States and the European Union. We need the transatlantic unity and consolidated position. This is something that we have to work on these days and to be prepared.
James.
It's an iron law of conferences that the most difficult and demanding questions come at the very end when there is no time.
Yep. There
was a question at the last session, 20 seconds to that, about scenarios for Russia. Are we prepared? Burnout is not part of my vocabulary or my analysis. I said under certain conditions, the Russian state will have trouble functioning as it does now in 2 to 3 years. One way or another, the Russia problem is going to be with us for at least a decade, and we'd be better getting used to it. What happens inside Russia is not something we should try to affect, and it is not our fundamental responsibility. Our fundamental responsibility is to protect whatever happens there, to protect our allies and our partners and our friends. I'm sure you're so happy that I forgot the Swift question.
Mariupol.
Lethal, very, very quickly on this. Don't forget who we're dealing with, please. Supporting Ukraine by defensive means in an intelligent and right and comprehensive way, I think, would be less risky than such a dramatic step as SWIFT. I think we need to think about that very carefully. Russia can turn off the gas tap to all European countries tomorrow, and with all the difficulties they have, they will be able to withstand the consequences of that for a period of months. And despite all the progress we made, there are certain countries in Europe that will be climbing up the walls in 6 days. I think we should think very carefully before taking such a step.
Prime Minister, Europe is not using its soft power as much as it should. It missed the chance of a Marshall Plan with Russia. Is there a chance for a real Marshall Plan now?
I wouldn't have mentioned it if I wouldn't have a belief in it. But, of course, we have to reckon that there are, if we talk purely about economic issues for a change, Ukraine has tremendous challenges. Yes. These reforms are by no means easy. We can and should help them as much as possible in those reforms. We can and should help them financially. But of course, at the final end, it's their will and actions what really count. And this needs this continuous determination. But I just want to say that I very much like what the gentleman said, mentioning the Berlin Brigade. This is a good parallel from history. I think the presence, Allied presence in all the Baltics and also Poland and other countries is crucial, and this deterrence part of European security is very, very important.
Ilya, you get the last word on the panel. I heard Zbigniew Brzezinski in Munich last year, say, of course, never let us lose sight of the fact that there is no solution for Ukraine without Russia's engagement.
I think that's pretty obvious. Because Russia is a side of the conflict, so how you can resolve the conflict without talking, engaging, interacting with Russia in one way or another, even if it is a military confrontation, it's still a certain way of interaction. What I wanted to say as the last word, we were here talking about the will. I had a little bit of my personal will. And that little bit of my personal will is now vested in the Ukraine success. We badly need this success, we in Russia. Mm-hmm. Because the success of Ukraine means changes in Russia. Mm-hmm. And Putin understands this very well. He already has done a great job. I think that no Bandera has done more job to create a political nation in Ukraine as Vladimir Putin. But now we need that the result of this would be turned into prosperity for Ukrainian people. Because military solution in Mariupol, this is, unfortunately, we have to face it as something that Ukrainians would need to do by themselves. Nobody would help you with this. But what we can do, and I want to remind everybody that Marshall Plan, which we already mentioned several times, was not about the debt financing. It was about investment. It was about making economy grow. It was about new industries, about new factories, about new production, about new jobs. It was not about rising tariffs for gas for the population of the countries that were subject to Marshall Plan. That was the other way around. And that's what exactly needed right now. And I think if everybody in this audience would direct your own will to this, then we would not test Berlin's situation where Mr. Putin was not so far from.
Thank you very much, Ilya. I think we've left, I fear, as many questions as we've answered them. I know that in the audience there were lots of questions I failed to get to. Just as you say the normal thanks to a wonderful panel, immediately afterwards, before you go for coffee, my good friend and colleague Nick Going has an evil plan which he wishes to put to you, or something like that. But first, thank the panel very much indeed.